Last week, NASA chose SpaceX's Falcon Heavy rocket to launch the first two elements of the agency's Lunar Gateway mission. The power and propulsion element and the habitation and logistics outpost, which together will form the first usable lunar space station, will be launched to space as one integrated payload. The PPE and HALO modules are targeted to launch no earlier than May 2024 from Launch Complex 39A at NASA's Kennedy Space Center in Florida. The total cost to NASA for this mission is approximately $332 million, including the launch service and other mission-related costs. The PPE is a 60-kilowatt class solar electric propulsion spacecraft that will provide power, high-speed communications, attitude control, and the capability to move the gateway to different lunar orbits, thus providing more access to the moon's surface than ever before. The HALO is the pressurized living quarters where astronauts who visit the gateway will work. It will provide command and control and serve as the docking hub for the outpost. HALO will support science investigations, distribute power, provide communications for visiting vehicles and lunar surface expeditions, and supplement the life support systems aboard NASA's Orion spacecraft. The HALO is being designed and built by Northrop Grumman, and Maxar Technologies are building the PPE module. About one-sixth the size of the International Space Station, the Gateway will function as a way station, located tens of thousands of miles at its farthest distance from the lunar surface, in a near-rectilinear HALO orbit. It will serve as a rendezvous point for Artemis astronauts traveling to the surface of the Moon. From this vantage, NASA and its international and commercial partners will conduct unprecedented deep space investigations. Recently, NASA has picked SpaceX to launch a telescope into orbit for a two-year astrophysics mission starting in 2024. The spectrophotometer for the History of the Universe, Epoch of Reionization, and ICE's Explorer mission, also known as SpheREx, is a planned two-year astrophysics mission to survey the sky in the near-infrared region. The mission serves as a powerful tool for answering cosmic questions involving the birth of the universe and the subsequent development of galaxies. It will also search for water and organic molecules in regions where stars are born. Astronomers will use the mission to gather data on more than 300 million galaxies, as well as more than 100 million stars in the Milky Way galaxy. SpheREx will use a spectrophotometer to perform an all-sky survey that will measure near-infrared spectra from 0.75 to 5 micrometers. It will employ a single instrument, with a single observing mode and no moving parts, to map the entire sky four times during its nominal 25-month mission. The telescope lens will have a diameter of 20 centimeters with 6 mercury-cadmium telluride photodetector arrays. The SpheREx spacecraft is provided by Ball Aerospace, while the payload is being developed by Caltech and NASA's Jet Propulsion Laboratory. The total cost for NASA to launch SpheREx is approximately $99 million, which includes the launch service and other mission-related expenses. The SpheREx mission is currently targeted to launch as early as June 2024 on a Falcon 9 rocket from Vandenberg Air Force Base in California. China's first Mars mission, Tianwen-1, arrived in orbit around the Red Planet on February 10. The mission was launched by China National Space Administration from the Wenchang spacecraft launch site last year on a Long March 5 rocket. The spacecraft is equipped with 13 scientific payloads to study Martian morphology, topography, surface regolith, and search for water ice. The mission will also attempt to study the characteristics of the Martian ionosphere, climate, environment, and magnetic field. Although Chinese authorities and state media have hailed Tianwen-1 as the country's first mission to Mars, China's first attempt to reach Mars was actually in 2011, with the Yinhua-1 probe. The probe was supposed to orbit the Red Planet and study its environmental structure, but the mission failed with a malfunction that stranded the probe in Earth orbit shortly after launch. After traveling through space for 7 months, on Wednesday, Tianwen-1 initiated a 15-minute burn of its main engine and slowed down the 5,000-kilogram spacecraft enough to be captured by Mars' gravitational pull. The Mars orbit insertion maneuver brought the spacecraft into an elliptical orbit of 400 by 180,000 kilometers, inclined by 10 degrees, with an orbital period of 10 days. The orbiter will spend the next few months scanning the surface to refine the target landing zone for the Martian rover that it is carrying on board. The orbiter is expected to approach as close as 265 kilometers to the Martian surface, allowing a high-resolution camera to capture images of the Red Planet. After scanning the Martian surface for about 3 months, The spacecraft will send a landing capsule carrying the 240-kilogram rover onto a massive plain in the northern hemisphere of Mars, known as Utopia Planitia. If the landing is successful, the solar-powered rover will explore the Martian surface for 90 days, studying its soil and seeking signs of ancient life, including any subsurface water and ice. The mission also serves as a technology demonstration that will be needed for an anticipated Chinese Mars sample return mission, proposed for the 2030s. The first Arab interplanetary mission reached Mars orbit last Tuesday. The mission, called HOPE, or the Emirates Mars Mission, was launched atop a Japanese H-2A rocket from the Tanegashima Space Center on July 19 of last year. The 1,350-kilogram HOPE orbiter carried a camera, an infrared spectrometer, and an ultraviolet spectrometer to study the red planet. The spacecraft was designed to provide data on the Martian atmosphere, including monitoring weather and climate to a greater degree than past Mars orbiter missions. After traveling through the vacuum of space for 7 months, the spacecraft conducted its most critical and complex maneuver on Tuesday, when the spacecraft was slowed to be captured by the gravity of the red planet. The probe fired all six of its thrusters for 27 minutes to cut its cruising speed of 121,000 km per hour to about 18,000 km per hour. As per reports, the ground-based team at the Mohammed bin Rashid Space Center received signals from the spacecraft after 11 minutes, which confirmed the probe's successful orbital insertion. Now, the UAE scientists and engineers will spend the next 2 months testing the spacecraft and its onboard scientific instruments before moving to its final science orbit. In its capture orbit, HOPE probe's nearest point above Mars' surface is 1,000 kilometers, while its farthest point is 49,000 kilometers. After three transition to science maneuvers, to move the probe from its capture to science orbit by April, the spacecraft will begin orbiting the red planet at altitudes ranging from 20,000 to 43,000 kilometers, with an inclination of 25 degrees. In its science orbit, with its three scientific instruments, HOPE probe will map a complete portrait of the Martian atmosphere and study its seasonal and daily changes. Moreover, the spacecraft is expected to collect more than 1 terabyte of new data, which will be shared with over 200 academic and scientific institutions worldwide, for free. Now, let's discuss some of the major Starship updates from the past week. SpaceX is now working rapidly to launch its next Starship prototype, serial number 10, as soon as possible. They will use all lessons learned from previous flights to try to ace the landing. On February 8, SpaceX completed Starship SN10's first cryogenic proof test. The rocket was pumped full of liquid nitrogen on Monday to ensure that the vehicle can withstand the temperatures and pressures it will be subjected to before launch. With the cryo-proof test complete, the next step will be a static fire test of the rocket's three Raptor engines. During the test, the rocket will be filled with fuel, and engines will be fired at full thrust, while the vehicle is held firmly attached to the launch pad. If SpaceX could conduct the static fire test earlier this week, there is a small chance Starship could fly before the end of the week. On February 13, Musk gave a 60% probability for the successful landing of SN10. In the meantime, workers are concentrating on Starship landing pad repairs and reinforcement. SpaceX is now thickening the landing pad by pouring more concrete and adding rebars to the structure. Rebars are used to improve the concrete's tensile strength and absorb the impact load in the event of a future Starship landing failure. After the failed landing of SN8, SpaceX had to cut out the damaged pad section and fill it with fresh concrete before the flight of SN9. Adding rebars and hardening the concrete will strengthen the pad to withstand heavy impacts without damage. Structural works are underway near the orbital launch mount. Three rings of rebar were spotted on a new concrete foundation by RGV aerial photography last week. These could be the concrete stands to hold Starship fuel tanks. Given the growing number of Starship and Super Heavy prototypes at the build site, SpaceX needs to build storage tanks to stockpile more fuel for future test flights. On Friday, workers were found building a new structure at the launch site, which could probably be the top portion of the orbital launch mount. These individual sections will be assembled in a circular fashion to complete the launch mount table in the coming weeks. The structure includes an inner wall for heat protection and cutouts to house piping. Future Starship launches will take place from this platform. SpaceX founder Elon Musk recently shared the company's top Starship-related priorities. he said that they need to build an orbital launch tower that can stack Starship atop the Super Heavy booster. During the 2016 Starship event, SpaceX had shown us how they are planning to lift and lower the Starship atop the Super Heavy booster with the help of the Crew Access Arm. And now, one of the top priorities of SpaceX is to build such an orbital launch tower that can support stacking. The next top SpaceX priority, according to Mr. Musk, is to produce enough Raptors to support Super Heavy flights. Super Heavy booster requires 28 sea-level Raptors for its orbital flight. These 28 Raptors, producing 65,000 kilonewtons of thrust, can lift the Starship upper stage, carrying 100 tons of payload into low Earth orbit. SpaceX is also concentrating on improving the Starship and booster empty mass. As a part of their effort to reduce the mass of Starship, SpaceX is now testing a new 3mm stainless steel tank at the Starship Boca Chica test site. With the reduction of steel thickness from 4mm to 3mm, SpaceX could likely cut 5 to 10% from Starship's empty weight. Recently, Elon Musk joined Joe Rogan for a third-round interview, where he discussed SpaceX and Tesla. During the podcast, Musk covered several details related to the design and development of SpaceX rockets, including the fact that he requested Starship's tip to be pointy because of the Sacha Baron Cohen film, The Dictator. Joe asked Mr. Musk how long it is going to be before Starship become an operational spacecraft. After pondering Mr. Rogan's question for a few seconds, he said that Starship is probably 2 years away from becoming an operational spacecraft. According to Musk, he expects to see a lot of flights between now and then, with an explicit goal of reaching orbit this year. He added that, if current trends continue, in 2 years, SpaceX should be doing regular orbital flights, with a high probability of safe landing. When asked what it feels like to see one of his prototype rockets explode on the landing pad, Mr. Musk replied that Starship is still in development, and each launch pad crash is very much part of the formula, and the rockets are meant to explode at this stage. He added that it's weird if it doesn't explode, because SpaceX is trying to develop advanced rockets at high speed. According to Musk, the whole rocket, including the engines, the structure, the avionics, the software and the ground systems, are all evolving simultaneously. And the entire production system is more challenging than the rocket design by far. During the interview, Musk briefly discussed the challenge of developing a heat shield and revealed the main issue that SpaceX is currently working on. According to Musk, ceramic heat shield tiles placed too close together will ultimately shatter or fall off when subjected to the stresses of Starship operations. Those stresses include the violent vibrations produced during the launch, as well as the expansion and contraction of the airframe that occurs when Starship's steel hull is cyclically heated and cooled by Raptor burns and cryogenic propellant. According to Musk, SpaceX is trying to determine how to install a heat shield with tiles that are neither too close together to cause damage during launch, or too far apart to allow the plasma produced during re-entry to find its way between those tiles. Moving on to the Starship build site, SpaceX has installed the nose cone of Starship serial number 11 atop the thrust section last week. Starship SN11, which is currently standing inside the high bay, will be rolled out to the launch site after aft fin installation. A recent flyover by RGV aerial photography spotted the thrust dome of booster BN1 lying at the shipyard. In this photo, we can clearly see the four anchoring points for the sea-level Raptor engines of the booster. Another image shows us the forward dome of the BN-1 booster, above which the Starship will be stacked. Watch our previous videos in the playlist to get updates about the remaining Starship prototypes. Link in the description. With this, we have covered all the major updates from last week. Please share your thoughts on the latest science news and Starship updates in the comments section. Also, do not forget to subscribe to the channel for more weekly updates. And as always, thanks for watching.